is Koleber. I'm the interim CEO and executive director. I would like to thank everybody for taking the time away from their busy schedules to attend this event. We certainly appreciate it. We have a wonderful event planned today with Mr. Charles Sisk, but before we get started, I would like to introduce our chairman of the board, Mr. Pete Liakakis.
Cutting my cell phone off so we won't be disturbed here. Good morning, everyone. Glad to have you here this morning. And it's a great day for Savannah. We really appreciate the attendance of the people that are here now. And our board, I'll be talking a little bit about our board members also and introducing them so that you'll know we've got a great group of members of our Chatham Area Transit Authority and have worked hard for the last several years for our different transportation projects and all. And one of the things that we have been concerned about is how we can be able to put together things to get more grants in, get more money, get more participation from people and all. And what we have done, we have, and for this particular seminar that we're having, is that what we are going to do, to have the top man in Denver, Colorado, who has led what they have done, going beyond transportation in the city of Denver. In fact, now they've got over 33 cities that are members of their transportation committee, and they have put together, I think you'll be finding out from our member now of that particular committee in Denver, and he's one of the top people, and he led all of the pushing and the things that were necessary to get the Denver people and the Denver business people, elected officials and all, to put all of that together. And what we did also, we had two of our members of our particular CAT board, and that is Helen Stone and Howard French. They went to a transportation meeting in Denver and attended that, and while they were there, they met the director at that time, was Charles Sisk, and he presented a program there and gave a lot of information to our two board members, and they brought it back to us to learn about what they were doing, and thankfully, we invited Charles to come to Savannah, and he agreed, and that's really good, because with his knowledge and all of the things that were put into place is really good, and hopefully that, and we doing this in our particular area, because what we have invited now, not only the elected officials in the city of Savannah and the county, but we also wanted it to be regional, like Charles has done in Denver. And we have invited people from, and elected officials from Effingham County, Bryan County, Liberty County, and Bullock County. And so good representation here today from those particular areas. So we're gonna see some things that we want all of you to join in and work really hard with us and support it, and we'll have a lot more people in this particular event. And now, what I'd like to do is introduce our board members. So when I introduce them, if they will please stand up, and we'll go from there. and then we'll call on Howard French, who was one of the members who went to Denver, Colorado, to introduce our great, great guest. First we have Howard French. Stone, Bill Dorrance, James Holmes, Frank Mendeldorf, and Wayne Dawson. Now, under the weather, we have had our vice chairman, Priscilla Thomas, who's been in and out of the hospital here a number of times in the last couple of months. And so she might drop in here a little later, but we wish her well, as always. And right now, what I'd like to introduce, one of the people that brought a lot of good information here, and Howard French, who's kept in touch with Charles while we were putting this together. Howard?
Thank you, Pete, and again, thanks everybody for coming to listen to what I think is going to be a very very interesting lecture for everybody. So it's my my pleasure. I get the best job here. I get to introduce Charles Sisk, who, as Pete said, we met in Denver. And I think we should give you a little bit of background of our meeting to let you know what we were out there for. We were out there for a conference, and it had transportation systems from all over the country. And typically, when we get involved in some of these lectures, we're a fairly small to mid-sized system, and we get just sort of lost with the big systems, Los Angeles, the Denver's, and the bigger systems. But the opening seminar was given by Charles, and it was really, really interesting. It dealt with transit-oriented development, and all the things that they had done from a regional standpoint, and the programs they put together. And his seminar took maybe an hour and a half, and Helen and I looked at each other, and we went, wow, this could really work for us. And then we took a road trip, and we split up. Helen did one tour, I did another tour. And we got to see what they were doing. Firsthand, we got to see where they had renovated and updated a parallel commercial area. We got to see in the middle of a field where they had built a parking garage and the whole community was sprung up. We got back from our trip and we ran into each other at the jewel of their restoration, which is the old historic Union Station. And we said, you know, this is really, really good. We bought the cooler last time. So we decided to start stalking Chuck. Because we wanted to learn more, so we stalked him. And eventually we found him by himself, and there we were. And we started the conversation with him. And then luck smiled on us. Because we found out that Charles is actually a college official on game day and travels the country officiating football games. And one of his favorite teams is the University of Georgia. So Helen, being very proud of you, so I went to the University of Georgia, and I know the people that maintain the mascots. So at that point, a bond was formed. He didn't really care about me because I was really terrified about that. But he agreed to come out and talk to us, and we're really glad. It took us about a year to pull this together. He's here, and we're really looking forward to it. So I asked Charles, what do you want me to say about you? And he says, I don't need a good introduction. I want big deal made out of him. So I can only tell you what I have learned by talking to him. He is a partner of Hearth, Sisk, and Blackmore. So he is a lawyer by training. He's a lifelong resident of Colorado. Interestingly enough, he was also an elected mayor of Louisville, Colorado, which is a small town between Boulder and Denver. 33 mayors that Pete mentioned, which we'll hear more of. He was the chairman of that committee of the planning group for the area. When Denver took over all of this massive and dramatic improvements and changes and renovation, he was chairman of the September 4th. And besides that, he's an all-around great guy, so let's welcome Charles Sisk.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here in Savannah. First, I'd certainly like to recognize the Chatham Area Transit Board and Chairman Pete and the other members for being so hospitable. You all have made this such a great trip and spending time that you have. I'd also certainly like to thank Howard French and Helen Stone and also specifically Beverly Dumas for introducing themselves and really getting a chance to visit with them when we were all in Denver, because we'll say this, you go on meetings, and certainly we'd like to say we're always in meetings, but I've got a true confession here. We weren't always in meetings. We had some meetings after the fact that allowed for some adult beverages, which were probably just as important as some of those other meetings, and I will tell you that it wasn't on anyone. It was on personal budget. I know, but the point is that when you go on meetings like this, what you really understand is you learn a lot about the people, and you learn about the fact that we all share so much in terms of what we're doing and where our true interests lie. Because these are times that you're spending away from your businesses, times you're spending away from your families. And you do that because you care about the community, you care about the greater good of what's going on in your community. And certainly all of you are here today. You could be doing other things, and I know they had to pay you lots of money to have you come to hear me, but I do appreciate that. So I have to pay extra after I'm finished. But the fact is that we have a common purpose here, whether it's Savannah or whether it's Denver, Colorado, or the metropolitan area. And that's something that in terms of coming in, the one quarrel I would take with Howard's introduction is you won't hear a lecture from me. This is going to be a discussion and something, because I'm going to learn more, and I've already learned about it from just being here and listening. I had the honor yesterday of going to a CAT board meeting, and Pete, you run a darn good meeting. I like the efficiency with which you run that. When I was chair of the RTD board for the last 2 years, I could have used some of your help to get people to move on. And I'm going to take that back and hurry. Seriously, it was something that what I really learned from that was that the Chatham Area Transit is experiencing many of the same issues that we're experiencing in Denver, as far as the issues may be such that you say, well, Chatham Area Transit serves, what, 300,000? Our Denver regional transportation is about 2.8 million people. But the fact is, when you really consolidate that, we're dealing with the same issues. And we have tasks ahead of us, because transportation, which is something that when I became involved as a council member and then a mayor pro tem and then the mayor of Lewiston, which is a town of about 20,000 people. Did I think as a mayor that I would be looking around saying transportation is something that really makes a lot of sense to me? Well, it became pretty clear that transportation is much more than moving people from point A to point B. It's also about economic development. It's about getting people to jobs, getting people to schools, getting people to hospitals. It really is. It's the nerve for your economy. And being a private business person, that really appealed to me, is that how can we work the public and the private sector and work together to make our area one that is much better if we come together and really coalesce, as opposed to working independently. Now, I would tell you this, and I want to share this as a concern that I have. Louisville is just outside Boulder, and I'm a big University of Colorado fan, and I went to see you twice, and I bleed black and gold, but we're about 15 minutes or 15 miles to 18 miles from Denver. And so when, as the mayor, you start saying, okay, we're gonna talk about, and you're gonna hear about fast tracks, you're gonna talk about saying, well, aren't all these monies eventually gonna go and be poured into the larger city, i.e. Denver? And what really struck with me was that we could, that we would all benefit as a region, because the fact is that the littler cities are such that we could benefit, because if you have a strong nucleus, your whole area, then people think of it as the greater Savannah area, and it's not. It's the towns and the cities and the counties around Savannah and Savannah that certainly benefit. And that was something that took a long time for us to really, as I say, come together. And it really took a lot of local leadership. And Chairman Pete was all too kind. I was only one of the many mayors that was involved. And certainly all mayors and certainly our staff deserve the credit for coalescing around this. Because as I say, we saw this as a greater opportunity. And it was something that, if we walk in, do we have like minds? Absolutely not, we weren't like minds. But it seems to me that when you're talking about your transportation system, it's not a Republican, it's not a Democrat, it's not an independent. It's something that can and should draw people together. And I would just say, as an aside, I was very pleased that the pass bill got through this year. And I think that there was at least some ray of sunshine from Washington saying, gosh, we have to have a transportation bill that has some length of time other than just continuing to extend the transportation bill. And that's something that was, in fact, very good news. So in terms of transportation, in terms of what we're doing, I'm not here to tell Savannah or Chatham County how to run your organization. But what I would like, if you leave with anything here, it would be the fact that it's a matter of collaboration. It's a matter of fact that my wife accuses me of using too many football analogies, and that's probably because I played football without the helmet. But anyway, and she could care less about football, but she supports my habit in that way and supports it in so many ways. But the fact is that it's a matter of being on the team. It's a matter of, again, no one needs to have the attention or have the spotlight shown on them. It's the fact that why are we doing this? And we're doing it because we care about our community, we care about the region, and we also care about our children and our grandchildren. Isn't that what it's all about? It's not a matter of having a road named after you or anything like that. It's not a matter of who gets the praise. So as I say, I know that when we talk about working together and we work as communities, I just hope that the mayors and the commissioners in your area can find a way and can really figure out that they can accomplish so much together. And it does require everyone to be working together. And certainly the staff is so important because I will tell you that any real recognition that we receive as elected officials really goes to our staff. And they're the ones that are working behind the scenes, and they're the ones that really make things happen. So I think it's so important that we understand that and that we emphasize that. And certainly elected officials come and go, so we get new elected officials, we can pass the torch. So with that in mind, just as a nucleus or as a background, I'd like to just present some slides, some of which may be applicable to Savannah. And I had the good fortune of driving through Savannah, and Bill spent his afternoon with me yesterday, and it was really it was great just to be able to see the community and see what's happening and see what you're doing, and as I say, get a little bit of feel. But please understand, I'm not here, and I would not be, I would not want anyone to think that I'm trying to tell Savannah or the outlying areas how to certainly run your region. Far from that. I just want to share some things with you. Maybe we can grab onto something that would work. So with that in mind, a little bit of background, and let me also say this: I'll be open to questions because that's going to be most important. But several years ago, 25, Denver was really looking at being locked in on in our own events. We were growing, we didn't have a transportation system. So, what happened was, it was probably the most single event, is that we, the voters, decided to build a Denver International Airport, which was in the middle of a perk. I mean, really, farmland. And how many of you flown to Denver? You know, that's, it's as we say,
in the country. It's a fur piece from Denver, and that's what it was built. It was, you know, you you needed to get a long taxi. Well, the fact is that it really was, it transformed Denver in terms of becoming an international hub. And what that also meant that, and I remember that to this day, driving with my oldest son down to DIA's opening on February 28th, 1995, and just being part of it because it was so exciting. And little did I know that this would be a real transformation. I mean, again, it was a new airport. So really what we said there was, okay, we now have this airport, and it's really important that the airport then becomes international. Now given the fact that we had no real rail transportation, we had some bus transportation with DIA, we didn't have anything else. So this then gave us some incentive. People will say, well, why didn't you build the train then and there? There was not the demand for it. But anyway, going forward, DIA was a real, it was really like a rocket ship for us. It was our Sputnik. So then what happened was as Denver grew, we realized that we were having the gridlock in Denver. We have I-25 north and south, and we have US 36 coming from Boulder, and we have 70, and again, it's not so much about what's happening, but for whatever, for a lot of reasons, people wanted to come to Colorado, come to the Denver metro area. And what we ended up doing was talking about the fact that we can't just build highways and build our way out of this. And besides that, our legislature was not very generous with road funds anyway. And so, that's another story. But we got together. So there was a group of mayors, and there was a group of and we had this group called the Metro Mayors Caucus, and we decided that we had a failed attempt on a ballot issue in 1997, where we got absolutely hammered in terms of trying to go out and get additional funding for RTD. But what we ended up doing was we said we can do a better job. So we all got together and said, how do we plan for the future? How do we plan for the future? And so it was really the genesis of the 36 mayors, or 33 mayors, it's up to 41 mayors now. So it's grown. But this was something that was so important for us to look at. And what I think it said was that we're not trying to get everyone out of their cars, we're trying to, again, give people alternatives, give people choices. And that was part of what we looked at. So the choices then were such that the development then of the Fast Tracks plan. Now, the Fast Tracks went to the voters in 2004, and it was a 0.6% sales tax. Now, I'm not standing here saying how you fund transportation improvements. Everybody's got their different ideas, but for that, that's what was more. And the idea was then that we would be building these lines, and it was very ambitious, but it would involve, in fact, lines that would take us, rail lines to the airport, bus rapid transit, you'll see to Boulder. It was all encompassing. It was something for the entire region. Well, keep in mind the entire region. I think we're talking about seven counties here that came together. So this was something that, in terms of being funding what we saw to be growth, funding opportunities, giving people alternatives, you're going to see that what we also did was we had parking spaces, we had new park and rides, some really fabulous park and rides, but again, we wanted to get people out of their cars and give them alternatives. And so that was part of what we're talking about. It was not so easy, because 2004, we were riding high, we had our sales tax models done. 2008, 2009, depression, recession, whatever you want to call it was a kick in the and all of us experienced that. At this point, you got this mayor from Louisville who scored a 2004 Fast Track. People are looking at him saying, there's rocks in his brain. I have to agree with him, but we run on it because we had a greater purpose. As elected officials, we have opportunities to make a difference, and sometimes we're gonna have to. We all have some missteps. But the point is that the economy did turn around. Our sales taxes have assisted us, and we've also worked on on many grants. The upshot is that this year is a pinnacle year for us at RTD. We're opening five different lines in 2016. Absolutely unbelievable in terms of what we're doing. And the first of which we opened on January 3rd, which was between bus rapid transit between Denver and Boulder. And I'm going to share that with you. But the point is, we just opened the new University of Colorado A line between Denver Union Station and EIA. Fabulous. 37 minutes and 24 miles, six stations. Important thing is, cost $9 one mile. And if you're over 65, which very few of you all are, but it's $4.50. So it's a screaming deal, and it gets people, gives them a chance. So what we said was, this is a good way, because what that did is it created stations. And so the other three lines will be opening later this year. So, you know, you can imagine our general manager's got a lot of things going on in terms of openings. And as a elected official, there's nothing better than to go into these ribbon cutting. I guarantee you, there's a lot of work that goes on before you ever get that. So anyway, this is what's happened in terms of 2016. The next slide that I'm just showing is just kind of a little encapsulation, but it really is the RTD history, which you know, the fact is that we're a 15-member board of directors, 15-member, now mayors and county managers and city managers and everyone else you can imagine, 15 board of directors. Now, that's a wide lasso, even by Colorado standards, but that's what was agreed by the legislature when it was created. So each director, which I'm has a region, and so I was elected in District O, and so I have 180,000 people as part of my district. So I've got I've got my cell phone posted for some unknown reason for people. But the fact is that we are elected, and my point is, and even as RTD, I hope that I continue what I thought as mayor. That is, we represent the entire region, not just our own district. And that's something that certainly is so valuable and so important, I think, in terms of having the little success that we've had in the Denver area. And again, this is all about the organization. So I take no personal credit whatsoever. So the next slide will show you a little bit about what the Fast Tracks plan was, which I previously alluded. But you can see all of this is the green area is that which we have not, which we're still working on. And I'd like to call a particular note. I know we're all looking at trying to find private-public partnerships, but the private-public partnership that we've been able to do in a lot of these areas involve going out to our business sectors and to various concessionaires and saying, we can help you, you can help us, and let's put deals together. And that's the way we got it. That's the way we got the Denver International, the A line, and two other lines built, because we received, believe this or not, we received over $1 billion federal grant. And we added to that, and the total line was $2 billion. And I'm so happy to report the lines were built, and built this with a private concessionaire. We were $300 million under budget, and that went back. So again, that's something you come back and you say. You say, look, this is what can be done dealing with the private sector. And oh, by the way, as part of that, what we've also done is we've talked about developing these station areas, which do in fact have the transit-oriented development areas, which are becoming, which are so important because they give people places to live, and it certainly gets people out of their cars or gives them the potential, and it allows all of us then to say, to again, come back and make choices. So, I'm not saying that the train or rail is for everybody, but I do say this. I think that what we're trying to do is to say to our taxpayers is that we want to spend your money wisely, and the best way we can result it, show them is that we build it on time and under budget. And that's, you know, that's something that, again, hopefully legitimizes, you know, what our mission is for that. But you can see in terms of some of the, you know, some of the, you know, the fact that we have 122 miles of light rail or commuter rail and so many new, you know, 57 new rail or BRT stations. I mean, it's pretty phenomenal. And again, that's, you know, that's for $2.8 million. It doesn't, what you all can do in Savannah, you know, would be just as important and certainly would have significant effects on this in terms of making decisions as far as what you do. So just to talk a little bit about this, what we've done is we've talked about completion, but the important thing is I want a Denver Union Station, and we'll see this down a little bit later, but Denver Union Station, RTD bought Denver Union Station, and it was the rail station, and it was dilapidated. It was the pigeons were having having more landings there than the passengers on the Amtrak. People didn't want to go there. I remember taking my mother-in-law there, and I thought, my gosh, you know, I don't have any problems with her, but I didn't much want to leave her there at Denver Amtrak, and that was years ago. Anyway, the point is that RTD bought this well before I was ever on the board. When people criticized me, said, "What are you buying this white elephant?" The fact of the matter is that since then, and that was before Fast Track passed, but when Fast Track passed, it allowed us to then use the Denver Union Airport, Denver Union Station, I'm sorry, as the hub for our whole transportation. We put in $500 million by way of various loans and loan packages. The result is right now we have development around Denver Union Station, downtown Denver, of over $2 billion, and that's private sector. We expect when it's built out, it's only about 10 years ahead of schedule in terms of build out. When it's built out, we expect it to be $4 billion. We're way ahead of paying the various RIP loans, the TIFIA loans, and everything else. And again, it was a combination with our car department of transportation, with the city and county of Denver, with certainly the federal government. And when we had a grand opening there in 2014, we had a whale of a party because it was really successful for the people that voted for Fast Tracks and said, we want something better for us in terms of transportation. We can't have a hub. And so that was part of what we did. And my point is that we looked at various alternatives, various grants to be able to make this happen and to be aggressive. And I could see that in terms of your board meeting yesterday. Your board members were saying, what are some of the other grants we can look at? How are we going to make this so that our money goes further? And this is not a handout, it's something where you earn it. You make good presentations. And so that's so important to be able to be, again, to be parlaying your opportunities, with the federal government, the state government, and certainly the local government. So there you go. This is what I just referenced. These are the lines that are going to be opening in 2016, and then you're going to see that we're going to open up another line, which is north on I-25, and that'll be in 2018. And then we're opening up another line in 2019, which is the Southeast Extension. I want to talk a little bit about Southeast Extension, just again. Collaboration. I just went to but we just had the ribbon cutting on that. That is a $208 million extension. And we were able to get under now small starts, $92 million. We just got the award as a result of the fast bill, $92 million. The local and private sector put in $43 or $44 million. And RTD put in the balance of the program. So we're building a $208 million extension. And from the transit authority, less than a third or so is coming in the transit authority. Again, working with the private and the public sector to make this happen. And it was so important for people. So that's something that, you know, I think it's not a lesson. It's something that not each community is going to have that same kind of incentive. But what they saw was a chance to have development in their area and to redevelop. So we were very, very fortunate. Let me talk a little bit about the Flatirons Flyer. This is a near and dear to me because I live in Louisville and I work in Boulder. But this is a BRT system. It's the first true BRT system we've opened, and it's 18 miles. And It's a station, and BRT, bus rapid transit, is something that we're seeing happen more often. And I would suggest to you that maybe something that people should look at and will be looking at. What it allows is mobility. It allows mobility and allows predictability. But you have to have lanes of travel. And so that's something that we were able to do on US 36, is that we built an alternate lane to allow traffic both the east and west, because we find that we don't have peak times necessarily. It's peak times in all directions, or both directions. But the planner and flyer is something that we have buses every 10 minutes. And that serves the communities. The point is that we were able by building an additional lane to get predictability with the fact that you can go from Denver to Boulder in 30 minutes. People said, we love that. We love the fact we can get on the bus. And we're also going to do we have eco passes, we have cards that carry over cards, smart cards, a lot of things that people liked, because that's, you know, we're trying to attract new riders. We're trying to attract the new millennials. We're trying to attract people to say, get out of your cars and give the bus a chance. And branding and everything, and work with the community. The point is that the success story of this is that we had very, very high ridership before we ever did the flyer and flyer. From August of 2015, before the flyer and flyer started, to January of 2016, and the flyer started in January of 2016, our increase in traffic, 45%. Amazing. And the cash that we put into that was not 45%, I guarantee you. It was something that we worked on that, and it's something that is a pretty incredible figure. Even as I stand here, I'm overwhelmed, because that's something we can do. So, the bus rapid transit is again predictability. It's people there, and it's redeveloping the areas. And when I was with Bill yesterday, I mean, you know, you think about, and I looked at Water Street and said, gosh, is that thing a potential? I mean, there's a lot of things going on in terms of what can happen in your area. Or conversely, I'm not saying is it I-16? Is it, where is it? But you know, that's another thing we're doing on US 36. Is that we're also putting now buses on the shoulder, so during peak time you can zip by the cars that are standing there, and they're in the bus, and those cars are looking over there, the single occupancy people, and saying, oh gosh, maybe I should get on the bus. I'm getting my place a lot faster. And it means, seemingly, at least from our standpoint, and certainly in Boulder, Denver, everyone, gives people the chance not to be parking their cars and paying fees in Denver and Boulder, which the parking fees, especially in Denver, have gone very, very high. We used to hear about $8, and that was per day, and now we're talking about $2, and that's $2 per hour. So it's really got a sticker shock. So Howard was good enough to put this in for you. This is the Colorado Buffalo slide here that we like. But in truth, this is the transportation-oriented development. Yes, we do have buffaloes, and so this is one area that actually, I'd like to tell you, is the transportation learning development that replaces this, but this is a wonderful point in terms of what transportation-oriented development did. And it does allow us to then develop some sites. And when we were visiting with Howard and Helen, we took a trip up to Broomfield. Broomfield was a town about midway between Boulder and Denver. And what happened there is that the Flatirons Flyer really and the transportation development has just spawned. And you see this. You've got new apartments, new condominiums. You've got new retail centers. You've got a sports center, an event center there, and this is all as a result of having transportation-oriented development for a community. Truly, what was there before was farmland, and it got a heck of a lot more valuable when they sold it and they transformed it. But it was all part of the private-public partnership. And people walk over. There's a parking lot there. You can drive. There's a garage for people, but you walk in and you can see the difference. And look at the bus there, that blue bus. You know, that's branding. People see that and they say, that's the Fire Orange Flyer. And we like it. We like it. So that's one of many places where transportation-oriented development, some people are calling it transportation-oriented communities, but whatever it is, you get the picture. A place that has some density and allows people to live there and walk and get on the bus and go to work, go to pleasure, and it has so many possibilities. But again, it involves working with the private sector. And I can't emphasize that enough. I alluded to Denver Union Station, and the picture that you had on the foldout. This is a picture of the Denver Union Station and the bus area, and this is where the trains come in. This is where the University of Colorado A line comes in. This is where the buses come in from Boulder, and we get off and you walk right downtown, and I walk to my board meetings, 2 blocks. I don't have to take the car. But Denver Union Station is Howard alluded, is quite a stunning transformation, if I say so myself. It's the old station that now has also the Crawford Hotel. And the hotel was built within the old station. They didn't move, so you got all these rooms, and the Pullman rooms and the studio rooms, and you have to duck under some bars because of the way it was done. But it's just absolutely stunning. And there are a couple of places to wet your whistle too, and then there's some great restaurants there. It's become the Denver's living room. And this is all because we all came together and said, this is important to have this be the nucleus or the heart for the Denver metro area. So I really invite you, if you haven't seen it, our bus terminal is there. We dedicated that. We dedicated that in 2013. We dedicated this in 2014. It's absolutely fabulous. So the point is, what is the point? The point is partnership, working together. This is not the city and county of Denver only. So many of us working together. So the slides are pretty well, of the Denver Union Station, and I like it. It's futuristic in some ways, but it's historical in other ways. We preserve history, and that was something that, being a fourth generation Colorado, at least means a lot to me, and I don't think it's history about it. So that's one of the reasons, many reasons I love being here in Savannah. You've got great history. One of the other areas that we visited was the Alameda Station. And the Alameda Station is really, it's in downtown Denver. It's right on the rail line, but it's also on the I-25. And it was an area that was a transportation-oriented development site. The developer got involved, and we had lunch there, and I think Helen was there too. We were ducking under wire, because that's what we were having. And they were in the middle of building these apartments, of doing that. It has become now, it really has been a renaissance for this area of downtown Denver, which was really, truly, I hate to use the word blighted because I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, but it needed a lot of help. It needed some people to get their arms around it. And so it was an urban renewal project. And the result is that we have 100% occupancy. We've addressed some of the issues with affordable housing. We've addressed some of the issues, certainly with income disparity, and it's been something that the retail has also serviced, and we provide transportation in terms of rail transportation, in terms of bus transportation. So it's become a semi-transportation hub with the amenities of people being able to live and even work there. So it's something that I think is it's going to get only better, because people want to be in those areas. They see them and they want to be in those areas. And from my standpoint, it also addressed some, not certainly all, of the affordable housing needs, because we worked really hard with the city and county of Denver to try to address that. And that was very important. So I know we wanted to talk and just spend a little bit of time about talking about the RTD and transportation-oriented development. We're committed to that in so many ways, because What it does mean is it means that we can allow people to come together. We allow people to certainly to have economic opportunities. We allow people to give them choices. And we also, in terms of working with developers, we're also able to certainly generate with other, you know, certainly, this is not just our team, this is cities. We work on low-income housing credits. We're able to work on, as I say, certainly the affordable housing issues. And some people are displaced when you have this renewal. So you want to be able to take care to certainly address some of those issues. So when we started this, we really thought, well, how big is this going to be? And in truth, the more we build this, the more demand we have. People want to get involved. So I think from an economic standpoint, the last statistic is really, you see this in transportation, but for every dollar we spend, we've gotten $4 in economic development. Now, you know, even the landscape business, that's not bad for but that's something that we've got to make sense with people. You've got to make it appear that this is something that we're all in this together. So that's a really important component, and we're going to see more of TOD, and you're seeing the FAST Act. They talk about TOD. There's TOD opportunities throughout. So that's something that I think all of us are going to be looking to avail ourselves is or some transportation-oriented development, and certainly, it doesn't have to be just the larger cities. It can be the smaller cities too, because I know in the little town in which I was mayor and still live, the Louisville, we're looking at TODs because. Once we got a rail station, we got some great opportunities. So, just pictures again, the Alameda, this is development sites, things going up for construction, just give you some idea. Density is, I think that's one of the things you have to understand about TOD sites. You got to commit yourself to some density. And that, some people say, oh gosh, I don't want density, but I want to make sure that we keep, at least in Colorado, we keep our open spaces. Well, there's a you've got to make some choices here. But one of the points of the TOD is that density does make it more attractive. Density allows people to, that's what we're looking at in transportation. We want people to be able to you don't want everyone to be driving or riding their bikes. In Colorado, we ride our bikes. So just let you know. But that's important to us. We have, a bike lane on US 36 for 18 miles. And that's something, part of the plan we made. We said multimodal and RTD. I've got hell about this from some people. RTD contributed to the bike lanes, and I'm proud of that. So, again, multimodal. This is an interesting corridor, the Welton corridor, only because we're doing an RFP in this year. But it's inner Denver, and it's truly in an area that needs. A lot of love and attention. We have end of the line and at 32nd down, and this is an area that is an area that if we're going to build it out and try to get this so that it becomes a project that that people of course will live and work, but it's inner city and it's hard because we're going to be displacing some people potentially in building condominiums, but it's also one that I think you work with the community and hopefully they'll understand that this. For the most part, this is really important. So the Welton project is one that I looked at, and I must say, it certainly, I looked at the waters project. Certainly, there's a lot of similarities between the Welton project and the water project. And I applaud you, by the way, what you're doing with the water street. That's very ambitious on your part, and I think very important. So the Welton project, just keep your eyes open, because key there is City of Denver is committing a lot of financial incentives to make things happen. We're all in this together. We have private enterprise. We've got housing issues, and it's stay tuned, because that's one to keep your eye on. The others I'm just going to skip through pretty fast. I don't know what our time is. Well, our time's going short here. Arvada is a town to the east of Denver. The line will open there at the end of September. That's a great elevator up there and a water tower. We preserve that to make that part of the city. And Arvada is a small town of about 60,000. They don't have, before this expansion, they didn't have one hotel. Now they've got one hotel as part of the RTD parking. And so it's you can imagine how excited they are, and they're also really excited to keep some of their sales tax dollars in the city. So, but I went to the grand opening there, and people there are just ready to go. The park and ride components are so important because they make people want to come to the park and ride. You know, if you've got a park and ride that has weeds and has, you know, doesn't have, you know, that is not very inviting, hey, I don't like people for not wanting to go there. I mean, you know, it's important to keep park and rides. So that's something to which we're really committed. And I don't mind the fact that there are times where if I'm driving down the lane of traffic, there's an RTD vehicle stopping because they're cleaning up the parking lots. I think that's great. Clean them up, make them better. The 16th Street Mall is really our most successful bus rapid transit. We just entered into contract using electrical buses on that. It's about 2 miles. It links our civic station to the Denver Union Station and goes right up and down the core of Denver. So you get off on Union Station, you get on the 16th Street Mall, and just hike up there and walk up there, and it's there's a lot of activity. We've been doing this for the last 15 years or so, and you know, we're trying to make some modifications with the city and kind of Denver. But again, something that we, as far as being core Denver, and that's free, by the way. The same thing is true with we have a mall ride that goes up and down that 16th Street Mall, but also we have one on H-Ing Mall. The idea is that. We want passengers to be able to come in downtown Denver and use our service. It's important, and a lot of them are using transfers anyway. So people say, well, you're giving someone away free. No, you're providing transportation. And again, as the transit board discussed yesterday, I think your fare is about 70 cents on a dollar, and that's what I recall. And I think our recovery is about 24 cents on the dollar. We're trying to get to 30, but you know, we'll see what happens. Again, the Metro ride, the same thing. Again, mobility, keeping people going in your city, and may not be applicable for all of you, but it's something that is very important for us. And then if I could close, I mean, the slide is, and I say, I'm not gonna stand here and try to suggest to you how you do it, what should be done, but you know, folks are coming, and I think we owe it to our children, to our grandchildren, to work on plans to really make a difference. And you know, the funding aspect is so difficult, but you really talk about putting together funding plans, but the genesis of that really is gonna be working together. I would suggest to you, Savannah can't do it by themselves. Chatham County, you know, can't do it by themselves. It's all hands on deck, and that's something that doesn't happen overnight, but it does. It does take the leadership and truly the foresight of leaders such as all of you to make this happen. And that's you know, in a lot of ways that's a challenge. I visited with a group from Lexington not too long ago, and we talked about the same thing. I didn't tell them I was a Louisville supporter. I just said we got along really well. But it was a very good visit because they're trying to get their folks together and how they can present things in a unified way. Because I guarantee you, when you go to Washington, your senators, your representatives will really like the fact that you're coming in as a group and saying, we have a common message. You know, we spent our time back in the Savannah area talking about issues, but we agreed there, and now we're coming back here to say, here's what we want to have. And some of this that we're talking about are situations where you, as I said, you know your city so well, but the idea of not having transportation to the airport in a good way is something that I know people were saying to us, we had bus transportation, which was good, it was every hour, but now we have train and we also have a bus terminal. It's great. People get off and they can go. They're welcome to our city. And you know, it seems to me that Savannah, I mean, goodness knows what you all have to offer. And so I just think there's so many opportunities for all of you to to talk about how you come together. And again, transportation is an economic driver, point and end of point. It can make such a difference in your community, and it can help your residents, because somehow if they can spend less time in their cars and more time at home, that's a pretty pleasant situation to have. So I would really just, as I say, encourage all of us to try to lead by example, and hopefully what we can do is see this, that the Savannah will be, the greater Savannah area will be much better, the Chatham County will be much better because of all of you working together. And whatever I can do, if I can give any assistance, I pledge that, but obviously you're the leaders and you're the ones that are gonna make the choices for your area. So I really appreciate you all taking the time to hear me out, and I will certainly welcome any questions that you might have. And rock on. Yes, sir. You're moving to Denver, back to Denver, you told me.
Maybe,
yeah. Oh, gosh.
Hey, listen, with Boulder's limited growth, how did that impede your build-out of fast tracks coming to Boulder Turnpike?
Actually, Boulder's limited growth is causing other cities to have grown. Boulder has a limited growth ordinance. And it was enacted about 20 or 25 years ago. But what's happened there is that it's caused other cities outside Boulder to grow. And that's one of the reasons why, when I first went to school at the University of Colorado, in the morning it was traffic coming in, and in the afternoon it was traffic going out. Now it's both directions. So what we're finding is truly one of the reasons why Louisville grew as fast as it did. And I think, but Boulder's been on board. They're a very transportation dedicated community. I don't say that only because I live there, but I represent them. But Boulder. Well, by the way, let me just share this with you about Boulder. Last year got Google, small little company you probably never heard, but got Google to commit, and they're tearing down buildings, to commit to build 130,000 square feet. 1,000 employees in downtown area of Boulder come out, and one of the reasons why they want to build, because RTD has a transit center within a block of where they're building their campus. You think transportation didn't have anything to do with that? It sure did. So it's very exciting in terms of having Google be a part of the of Boulder, Colorado. I guarantee you, they had a president before. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for joining us today. I'm concerned about the visual impact of our buses or whatever we put on the streets. We're known for a beautiful city, and yet we have rolling billboards coming through with wraps all around the buses, and they say that's to subsidize, but from my calculations, they're only subsidizing 0.3% of the budget. And so do you have any comment about how we can keep our vehicles attractive as well as productive in other ways?
Well, that's probably a comment that probably I should say. It's kind of like my going into my wife's kitchen and telling her how to cook. I'd probably be better off. But the advertising is a tough issue, and your board talked about the issue yesterday. It's something that we certainly at RTD have. We have some advertising, and there's a full push in terms of branding as opposed to advertising, as opposed to wraps and how they're displayed. And the trying to balance the fact that we don't have fare box revenue, we have to find other ways with advertising, I would just suggest to you is something that all of the transit authorities are trying to, are dealing with. And certainly I don't pretend to be any advertising or marketing genius, but I will tell you this, that I do think that from our standpoint, we want our buses to be attractive, to be clean, to be presentable. And yet, I will tell you that I've sat in on city council meetings in the Boulder area where they want less advertising, and so the point is that it is something that is, I won't say it's controversial, it's something that needs to be worked out with the agencies and the, certainly the cities, and understanding that, we want to have good taste, and as my wife reminds me, the only taste I have is in my mouth, so we'll just leave it at that. Yes, ma'am.
So as the transit has developed, and the neighborhoods have developed around the transit, we necessarily get some displacement. The economic development often means that the people who were there before don't get to benefit from the development that happened as they get displaced. So I'm wondering, if you knew then what you knew now, and you were starting again with your regional approach to transit, would you think about housing a little bit differently? Are there things that you would do differently to try and stop the development?
Let me repeat that, if I may. It has to do with displacement of people in terms of how to deal with the housing and for people that have been displaced, because it's something that that we recognize, because a lot of the areas that are being developed are areas where the rents are depressed, and so what we're trying to do, and again, we can do so much of a better job, is work with the cities. In terms of trying to say, how do we work for Section 8 housing or federally funded housing? How do we try to address some of those issues up front? Are we spot on that issue? Absolutely not. But I think the fact is that by addressing it as early as possible, it certainly will allow people to make some choice. Anytime you build a new area, you're going to displace some people, and I think that's got to be taken as a given. How you treat them and how you try to make plans for them, that's a key point. And I think that's something that again, certainly in Denver RTD, we could have done a better job. What we tried to do is learn from the way we've handled it in the past. Where the Alameda station is a perfect example for us. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I was just in Denver and Boulder in November and used the system extensively and found it wonderful, including the website, which was very user-friendly.
Oh my gosh, thank you.
And I noticed the extensive bicycle facilities at the parking lot. But my question for you is, does the system collaborate with the public school systems to reduce the number of yellow buses transporting public school kids?
The answer is, or the question is, working with the public schools in terms of yellow buses. What we've done is this: certainly in the city and county of Denver, we have a number of people that have eco passes that travel to schools. RTD does not look at their role as being in lieu of school buses, but we also say we also run systems so they go by. As many schools as possible. So as again, to give the students, and more importantly, the parents options to have our children go on public transportation. Because what we found is that it's the issues that we have around schools and the drivers, and I'll give you one small example, was our police in Louisville, where I live, did a radar close to the school. And what they found was the students did really well on speed limits. You know who violated the speed limits? The parents leaving the school and trying to get to work. And my daughter reminded me that. But we do work with the school system, but again, we do not see our role. I mean, again, keep in mind, the University of Colorado is located in Boulder. You can imagine, they have an EcoPass, 30,000 people that use our buses. So, you know, to the extent, or Auraria, which is the metro campus, three different universities, they have eco passes. They use our buses. So, you know, I like to think certainly we have a very student friendly environment, and we look at this as again a augmenting the local school system. But I would say the universities in Pittsburgh or colleges really like RTD and what we do and how we provide service. And we like them too. University of Colorado A-Line was named because they were an advertising contract with the University of Colorado, but they're paying RTD $1 million in advertising per year. Like, you hear that, Terry? For advertising. And, you know, there was some kickback about that, but that's something that is important. Certainly drops to our bottom line if we can use the money. Yes, sir.
What role does the state of Colorado play in funding transit?
The role that state funding is that we have, our legislature has not necessarily stepped to the plate. We're in the low 40s as far as transportation funding. And that's one of the reasons why we've gone out and done private concessionaires. Right now, what we did with US 36, it was a private concessionaire to expand, to get the additional lane, turned it over. It's now it's an HOV lane, it's an HOT lane, and it's also RTD lane. RTD contributed monies to build the extended lane about a fourth of the cost. But we have some real concerns about the state of Colorado in terms of how they've stepped up. Our car department of transportation, we have a new director, is absolutely fabulous. He's very innovative, and that's one of the reasons why I think states are looking at this and saying, we've got to step out of our own shadow here somehow and do innovations. And that's something that we're seeing within the last several years in the state of Colorado. I'm proud to say that. But as far as, and interestingly enough, on surveys that we're seeing, is that citizens now are starting to say transportation dollars are really important, and there were going to be some initiatives on the ballot this year, but they chose to pull them off because, truthfully, we couldn't come to an agreement. There wasn't enough of a transit component. They wanted to build the highways. So, I think we're making progress in terms of what we're doing. We've got two really innovative Department of Transportation executive directors in the last 5 years that are really trying to figure it out. Then we've got the legislature trying to figure out. We've got rural legislature, we've got their urban. Anyway, enough. Yes, sir.
With all the different partnerships and city governments, how did you handle all of the contracts?
Well, we are procurers. I mean, the contracts are such that we've had a city or an RTD lawyer. We have a big staff of RTD. Ty would like to hear this. We've got in-house people, but we've got staff about 20, and we pretty well keep people busy in terms of contracts and certainly working on them. We had one person that was our chief counsel, Marla Lane. She was with us for 25 years. Just retired. She was absolutely extraordinary. The Denver Union Station involved 11 different financing packages. And you can imagine that, trying to trust her. So the fact is that the financing packages really do require a lot of certainly from the accounting point of view, from the legal point of view. I mean, and again, it's being creative. And I think that's something that we're at least trying to learn. We have some really good legal staff, and I know you have a great lawyer in Ty as well, and I can see that yesterday, but it really, really means a lot to have somebody that has the historical knowledge and certainly, obviously, the interest of the agency. Yes, ma'am.
Denver is the Mile High City, so I don't know what that means in terms of pollution when you start building out extensive rail lines.
Well, it means we're the Super Bowl champs. How's that? And boy, did I love collecting money from my New England Patriot fans. Not to play them. And I'm sorry about the Carolina, but
when
I talked to Ms. Flowers, Carolyn Flowers, I did apologize. She's with Federal Transit. Okay, yes, yes, ma'am.
How would you say an area like Chatham County deal with the potential impact to the environment with pollution? Was that addressed in any of
sure.
the build-outs?
It absolutely was. I mean, we looked at this and said getting cars off the road meant less pollution. Putting people in buses, and as I said, we just did electrical buses up and down the 16th Street Mall. We're trying to give people choices as far as riding bicycles. In the old days we had horses, so they polluted too. But we've grown a little bit that Mile High City. The fact is that we're looking for certainly buses that are less polluted. Right now, we're still using diesel buses because our staff's made a decision that they're better for what we have. But that's always something that what you have to be aware of is. The more cars you take off the road, seemingly that's gonna have some impact on our area.
One last question.
Sure.
Any plans for light maglev or high-speed rail?
We are, we're well behind California in that regard, but the answer is really no. For us, that's right now we're using commuter rail, electrical rail. So the answer is I don't see that. But we're, interestingly enough, on part of what we're looking at too is we're looking at driverless cars to help get us the, get the, our less fortunate around in terms of some of the people that, that need less accept or more accessibility. So we're looking at that very strongly. We're also working at, looking at working with Lyft and with Uber. Yes, sir.
When I've been to Atlanta and also in Stockholm, there's a really cool integration between the public transit and public art and different art installations. Has Denver done anything like that?
Absolutely. Our art is, we have art at all of our stations. And we are, we're very committed to having the stations we just opened on the University of Colorado line have art. We dedicated the stations and tried to have the artists there. The line that we're going to be opening in September, we've had, again, local collaboration. And, you know, the one thing I just told them is make sure you don't have the director to be part of the art selection. Just let the people know what they're doing. Keep the elected officials out of the way. But yes, I mean, it's really important. Again, it's a matter of welcome to the stations. That's what we call them, stations, because we want people to feel like they're invited.
Very cool.
So I think I'm getting the hook here, but not the first time. But thank you so much for letting me spend time with you.
We want to thank Mr. Charles Sisk for coming out on his own time to do this. I know he's an advocate for this, and we really appreciate it. We would like to present you with this gift.
Well, thank you.
We appreciate it.
All right.
Mr. Charles Sisk, everybody, thank you for coming.